Harper Wave and Harper Audio present The Beautiful No and Other Tales of Trial, Transcendence, and Transformation by me, Sheri Salata. For Annie and Julia. Based on many, many true stories. Tell me your story and I'll tell you mine. Jack Benny Jr. High, we proudly sing your name. Our teams will never yield as they go down the field. They will lead us on to fame. Jack Benny 39ers Fight Song, 1971. So here is my story. It's about how a regular middle-class girl from Waukegan, Illinois, grows up to run one of the most beloved brands on the planet and one of the most successful television shows in history. And then, after all that dreamy on-the-jobness, finally figures out how to live the life of her dreams. Like any good story, it begins with a quest. I wonder, all these years later, if my quest wasn't actually launched in grade school. After my Navy dad retired from active duty, we settled in my parents' hometown, Waukegan, Illinois. This bustling mini-metropolis was an hour north of Chicago and claimed as its favorite son the legendary comedian of yore, Jack Benny, who was quite famous for always saying he was 39 years old. Hilarious stuff for its time. I was a proud Jack Benny 39er, enrolled at the junior high institution that still bears his name. We Waukeganites really milked the Jack Benny connection. That is, until another hometown hero, Jerry Orbach, hit the big time in the mega-hit TV series Law & Order. It was in eighth grade that I had my first real brush with showbiz. After years of waiting on the list, my Auntie Barb scored impossible to get tickets to Bozo's Circus, which taped in downtown Chicago at WGN Studios. I was entranced by the big studio cameras, and even though I was the oldest child in the audience and twice as tall as the itty-bitties, I loved the energy of the live taping as the crew scurried around the set. There was a make-or-break tension that felt like life. I wasn't selected for the grand prize game, but snagged the second most coveted spot on the show, introducing the cartoon. Mr. Ned, in his top hat and red tails, cozied on up to me in the bleachers as I proudly faced the camera and declared, "Folks, here's Huckleberry." I was a born producer. In my earliest memories, I'm leading groups of my little pals in live productions of Barbie, High School Musical, decades before the blockbuster movie, and The Life and Times of Uncle and Aunt Sam. It always bugged me that she was not represented. All involving acres of crunchy crepe paper, Elmer's glue, and the big box of Crayolas. As the oldest grandchild on both sides of my family, I was pretty much in charge while the adults were sipping their Manhattans, martinis, and scotches. My brother and first cousins on both sides were my beloved cast for all of our family skits and musical spectaculars. Though they sometimes balked at my relentless rehearsal schedules, they always loved the standing ovations that came after. Everyone does. Producing is multifaceted. First, you have to be a bit of a visionary and love that dreaming things up process. And then, it doesn't hurt if you like to herd the kittens, as they say, because you are in charge of the whole shebang. But it is absolutely essential that you have real storytelling chops. I polished all of those skills in my spare time for most of my life, and one magical day, they led me to the greatest show on earth, The Oprah Winfrey Show. The producers were arguably the most prolific storytellers in TV, and every kind of story under the sun got told in the hallowed halls of Harpo Studios. Spiritual stories, lesson stories, literary stories, famous people's stories, historic stories, giveaway stories, makeover stories, and the kind of deeply personal stories that could make you laugh out loud, shout, "Aha!" or bring you to the ugly cry, as Oprah coined. People's stories mattered, and that is no doubt why untold millions tuned in around the world from every walk of life for 25 years. As a writer and a producer, I have honored the impactful nature of stories for a long time, but it's only now in the middle of my life that I understand their awesome quantum power. I can see clearly now that stories are the actual building blocks of our lives. They are the ingredients of our intentions, our deepest desires, our requests to the universe, our hopes, our most fervent prayers. And the most crucial stories are the ones we author for an audience of one, ourselves. That's right. What we say to ourselves, about every area of our lives is life and death, the difference between the joyride and the hard road. It almost seems too simple, which is why I think we miss that nugget over and over again. I had a front row seat to some of the most enlightened people on the planet: Deepak Chopra, Dr. Maya Angelou, Marianne Williamson, Yanla Van Zandt, Bishop Jakes, Eckhart Tolle, Cheryl Richardson, Gary Zukav, Wayne Dyer, Jack Canfield, Debbie Ford, Louise Hay, Janine Roth, Dr. Phil, Dr. Oz, and the list goes on, sharing bushel baskets of wise pearls. And while I ate up every teaching, every word with a spoon, it's only now that I understand that the stories I tell myself matter more than anything. Believe me, it requires constant rewiring because those neural pathways of unconsciousness at this stage of my life have some well-worn grooves. I'm as quick to put myself down, reach for guilt or shame like a Triscuit with French onion dip as I ever was. But what I focus on now is catching the first few words of that deflating, cynical story before it becomes a paragraph. When I hear that dream-killing voice, I literally say out loud, "Not helpful, not helpful," a life-changing tip from spiritual teacher Esther Hicks, as I snap myself back into the now. Somehow, we think of it as being vain or being too self-absorbed to tend to ourselves and our stories properly, to give ourselves the benefit of the doubt, the pat on the back, the word or two that raises our spirits and reminds us of how extraordinary and divine and beautiful we really are. I'm going to guess that you're like I was for so many years. You talk to your pets or to a stranger's baby in a grocery store with so much more love than you have ever spoken to yourself. There are a lot of supportive choices you can make, heart-opening, inspiring information you can begin to digest. You can read every book, including this one, go to every seminar, sign up for every retreat, but in the end, you will have to be the one to rewrite the stories of your life. Meaning, you will have to be the one who dissolves the lies of unworthiness, not good enoughness, I can only have thisness, other people are luckier than meanness, things will never work outness, money isn't everythingness, I don't careness, and recast it all with new beliefs, full of love, beauty, grace, power, and abundance. And I tell you, it can be done. You can read about transformation. You can talk about transformation. You can produce talk shows about transformation. But only you can be transformed. Moment by moment, day in and day out, the world is reflecting back to you the stories you repeat to yourself on autopilot. You are the author and the storyteller, and ultimately the experiencer of that creation. The good, the thrilling, the painful, the downright awful, all of it. At 56 years old, I found myself ready and willing to rewrite almost every single story of my life. And it will be, until the end of my days, a work in progress. But that intent and focus has taken my life in a wondrous new direction. Here is an offering that you may find helpful. It's never too late to make the rest of your dreams come true. And if not now, when? Chapter 1. If not now, when? First we were so young, and then we were so busy, and then one day we woke up to discover we were at an age we once thought of as old. Anna Quinlan, lots of candles, plenty of cake. It's 8:30 in the morning, and I'm still in bed. Bella and Kissy, my English bulldogs, are snoring in unison. Outside, birds chirp in what sounds like an a cappella choral arrangement, interwoven with the far-off buzz of neighborhood lawnmowers. Haven't heard those sounds on a weekday in ages. I feel as if I've just woken up in another dimension. Where am I? Who am I? What's happening? The sun is up, morning has broken, and I have nowhere to go, nowhere to be. My calendar is empty for the first time in decades. The B-track whir of obligations, demands, responsibilities to others, and devotion to a mission I treated as my noblest calling is echoey silent. I'm not sure how I feel, but I do know this moment marks a categorically different phase of my life. Yesterday, after nearly 21 years of some of the most demanding producing work in television, the historic farewell season of The Oprah Winfrey Show, the stressful own turnaround, and the bittersweet closing of Harpo Studios in Chicago, I stood before the OWN staff and spoke for the last time as co-president. Today, I'm leaving OWN to make a dream I've had for a long time come true, to open a company of my own. What lights me up is storytelling, producing. That is where my heart is. Oprah, you put the world at my feet and opened the door to a spiritual life that makes this moment possible. Being with you day in, day out these years has been one big super soul session. And to all of you, my colleagues from the beginning and those newer to the staff, thank you for being part of my wonderful life. Our Los Angeles staff had gathered in my favorite spot at OWN, the Magical Cafe, full of light, pine, and potted trees, while the New York and Chicago staff joined in by video conference. Oprah and I shared my news with senior staff 30 minutes earlier. This speech was the final step before my departure. I felt calm and certain and centered. I had already shed my tears the night before while putting my parting words on paper. What a ride. What a journey. And now it was over. It was time to move on and tend to the whispers wafting in and around me that were getting louder and beginning to scream that my life needed serious tending to. Yes, I was about to follow a new professional dream, as I told the gathered staff that day. But the truth is, that was only a small part of what was on my mind. Work had always driven the narrative of my life, so that piece was a no-brainer. It was a big bucket of personal life mess that was really calling my name. I'm a true blue, loyal to the bone kind of person, and usually it would take nothing short of a devastating betrayal to drive me from someone or something to whom I have pledged my heartfelt devotion. And I had been devoted to my job for a very, very long time. But on a soul level, this transition felt ordained, as if the universe was requiring my full and complete attention ASAP, and there wasn't a second to lose. I could see from the podium that my news caught people by surprise. When I finished, I soaked up the goodbyes just for a few moments. Then Oprah and I headed to the elevator up to the offices one last time. Upstairs, I supervised some final packing, waved farewell, picked up my purse, and headed to my car. The drive home felt like one of those big-deal life moments that you generally don't recognize as such until much later. I knew I was supposed to be feeling something, but I didn't yet know what it was. I put down all the windows of my Range Rover, opened the sunroof, and had my own little Sheryl Crow moment as I took myself down iconic Santa Monica Boulevard, the drive to my house. Arriving home, I grabbed the phone, checked in with the people I love most, cuddled up with my puppies, put my feet up with a glass of wine, and went to bed early. As I drifted off to sleep, my last thought was about what to do with this sense of overness, but that would come later. The next day, I wake up to just me, the girls, the birds, and the empty space that used to be my schedule. It's day one of life after Oprah. I move through the morning in a cocoon, I feel numb. The world looks different without busyness to clutter and distract me. My brain is on pause. I have no feeling in my heart, except a tiny little pilot light flame of joy that I won't identify.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.